here with Anna, who is a gamer, so much of a gamer that we almost started talking about games before we started recording. But before we get into that, I'm going to try something a little bit different this time. Instead of introducing Anna to you guys, I'm going to let Anna introduce herself. So Anna, tell people who you are.
Hi, thanks. So my name is Anna Valens. I'm a journalist. I'm a games journalist, also a bit of a games critic. Mostly what I do is I write about games that I really enjoy or like say, Nuclear Throne or Street Fighter V, and I kind of talk about the cultural issues related to those games, like, say, representation of female characters in those games, or maybe why people specifically like games because of mental health reasons or cognitive reasons. So I kind of take this focus on traditional games journalism and criticism in a more kind of... in-depth look and kind of ram it together in a lot of my work.
Yeah, you're in a similar field. I am. This is one of those ones that is going to straddle sort of the dialogue options party chatter thing, guys. So I maybe do the audio off the top, but it's dialogue options, and I'm here with Anna. There we go. You call yourself a journalist. I used to do that. I've started doing it less and less now because analyst is more accurate. It's more research and analysis than actually going out and, you know, okay, this side said this and this side said this and here's a third party for context. So why do you sort of identify still as a journalist as opposed to an academic or an analyst?
You know, that's a good point. I didn't actually think of that necessarily, but a lot of the work that I do, because I'm talking about more of a critical kind of look at these games, I do actually end up interviewing, like, say, players, or I interview the developers themselves. There's actually a really interesting article about visual novels from the West compared to the East that I did for Den of Geek that's coming out hopefully relatively soon. It's in edits right now. And I actually reached out to two developers of these really kind of prominent Western visual novels, and I interviewed them. And for me, that becomes more journalistic work because you're kind of, so to speak, getting in the field and getting those developers' direct kind of perspective on the matter.
Yeah, it really does sort of straddle the line, doesn't it? Because it's first-party research, but it's journalism as well. And I know, like, I'm zeroing in on this because this is something I struggle with myself, is that there really isn't, when you go to source a paper, when you go to look for citations, there isn't a lot out there. And a lot of the stuff that's out there is pretty questionable. Have you found the same thing?
You know what? That's a really good point. I have, actually. One of the big problems is that, like, so my major in college, I just finished college and I did literature.
Yeah. Yeah, that's what I was in college for too.
Oh, okay, no way. Yeah, there's a lot of us in games that are in that study literature. It's interesting. But so what I have a lot of experience with as someone that did literature studies was, like, you go on a database of academia and you've got everything you want of any subject ever is there. Mm-hmm. In games though, you do kind of have to pick through and figure out what it is. And I think one of the problems that you run into is that a lot of the research that's done is done kind of like how there's citizen science. It's like citizen research. Mm-hmm. And that can be great and really cool because it's kind of like crowdsourcing it. But then also, if someone's got a faulty method to that scientific research and you put that in as a really key piece in your pitch or your article or whatnot, you've got like half an article that's like dead in the water. And your readers are going to know that too, because those readers really do care about accuracy.
Yeah, it's an issue, especially when you get into women's issues, because so much of the stuff that we've got is a lot of unverifiable first-party narratives. So people telling their stories, and, you know, studying literature, we both know that first-party narrative is important. Getting people to tell their stories and incorporating different voices into what we consider literature. I mean, the sort of comparative lit courses I had to take introduced me to, you know, Gabriela Garcia Marquez and things like that, magic realism, which is so influential in video games.
Oh,
but,
yeah.
You know, the thing about an author is that they're from a place, they represent a certain viewpoint, and so to say any single author sort of defines magic realism or defines romance, you get into gaming and that's really messy. How do you sort of navigate that when you're taking, because I've basically just thrown them all out and made up my own methodology, because I found that so much of the stuff from literature, it hit this wall, and that wall was gameplay.
Yeah. Oh my God,
Right?
it's bad.
It's
Yeah.
almost like the things that are most useful are stories with quantum endings, stories with unreliable narrators, because then you get that interplay.
Yeah.
You know, but
Yeah.
other than that, I mean, Lord Byron doesn't tell me very much about games. How do you
No, he
navigate
doesn't.
this?
Yeah, I think that's a really good point because I mean, a lot of the things that come up when we talk about games and we talk about games writing in relation to gameplay is that kind of term that's become like such a cliche, like ludonarrative dissonance. Like everyone loved to use that word just a few years ago, and no
Yeah.
one wants to use it now for that reason. Yeah, oh my God. Because it's so easy to wipe everything into that one word and then just feel like everything is ludonarrative dissonance. Well, it's actually not. I feel like a major problem, though, is that we're still trying to figure out the terminology to talk about games writing. I think a big thing is that we're lucky because actually games writing is not that different from, say, when you're looking at things like the choose your own adventure kind of structure that we've seen, because it is about you have a branch and then it goes into different directions, but like you know, for instance, that your start here is going to be your start in every other game. But I guess really the biggest problem that we have is since we don't know how to like put words in, or we don't know how to describe things that happen in games writing, we don't know how to put words to them. A lot of us are kind of scrambling for meaning in a ways that like ends up with so many people confused and having different ideas. And I feel like the industry is going to move towards centralization, but it's still just kind of tricky right now to get that out.
Yeah, I compare it to working with jazz musicians, that you'll get people from three different, you know, the self-taught, the, you know, what I call real jazz, people who just picked up an instrument. So you get that neat roughness and that interesting syncopation because they haven't had the quirks trained out of them. But four different musicians will have five different terminologies for the same thing. And you know, you work with the same people over and over and over again. You know, I've talked to people who come from film and they work on their first game, and one developer told me that they actually had to do a chart because certain things in film are, it's the exact same word, but it means something different in games. And to me, and I want to see where you come from with this, the concept of plot versus gameplay is one I feel that hasn't been dealt with sufficiently to this point, because a lot of the stuff that's plot in a linear story gets almost dismissed as a gameplay element. It becomes something different, right? Because, you know, a big thing, Ahab fighting the whale in Moby Dick, that's plot. In a game, it would be gameplay. So how do you handle that, and what do you think the best way to sort of tackle that? We've almost got a fifth dimension to gaming that we don't have in filmmaking.
Yeah, I think that's a good point. I think it also reflects on the fact that, you know, gamers, players come to different games for different reasons. Some are going to really want gameplay over story, some are going to want story over gameplay. I think kind of a starting point is, there's a lot of different parts of kind of the gaming community at large that think, you know, one must be better than the other. There must be this focus on X over Y. You know, gameplay can be pushed to the side if a good story's there, or vice versa. But I feel like what really needs to be brought out is this idea that you really do need to have a solid structure for both. Like, I think BioShock Infinite is a really good example. That's a game where it's fun to play, and it had a really nice start to the story, but at least personally for me, as someone who likes BioShock, I felt like the story went from really strong to kind of weak and dissipating over time. And, you know, you'll have the argument that gameplay is more important than story, but for a series like BioShock, the story is absolutely vital to the player. People don't play BioShock just to, like, shoot things. A lot of people, like, personally connected with the original Ayn Rand kind of philosophy that was in the first game, that deconstruction of it, at least. So I think a major part of it is getting people to look at narrative as a really important part of games, probably on an equal footing to gameplay. And then looking at the idea of like, well, does this game need to focus on it more than others, but like still understanding it's one of many building blocks that makes a good game.
Yeah, see, that's where we get into this ludonarrative term, which I wish more people would use without tacking the term dissonance onto it. Because ludonarrative is BioShock Infinite's a great example of that, mm-hmm. because to me, just when the game started to get messy from a narrative perspective, it also got messy from a gameplay mechanic where the skyhook mechanics didn't work the way I think they initially envisioned. It was almost too fast. Yeah. So for the majority of people who are playing on consoles, you couldn't hit anything without a keyboard and mouse.
Oh,
you know?
That was bad.
And then those George Washington robots that clearly, and the handymen who clearly, it seems to me, had a much bigger part to play as the game was originally designed. It was one of those things that was just ripped out at the end to ship. And I agree with you that I think that if the story is not there, then it's almost like the tension required to explain the gameplay choices isn't there.
Yeah, exactly.
And I mean, like, the big thing, you've played the first three Uncharted games, you said, right? Or you haven't?
I haven't, but I'm familiar with the series.
Okay, we'll skip those because I wanted to talk to you about Nathan Drake and the whole, he's a killer. Like, that's an example of something people say is ludonarrative dissonance.
Right.
And I disagree. The game is telling you to shoot bad guys. And climb stuff. The game allows you to shoot bad guys and climb stuff, right? The game, and it's not like in Infinite where the game encourages you to protect Elizabeth. That's your job, to get her out of, what the hell do they call that city? Columbia, that's
yeah,
right.
Yeah, Columbia.
Yeah. but she's totally self-sufficient. You know, you're getting knocked out in gunfights all the time. She's totally fine.
Yeah.
And that, the game telling you you're supposed to be doing one thing, but actually allowing you to do something totally different is what ludonarrative dissonance is to me. But you're right. It's used as this catch-all term.
Yeah, it really is.
Do you think that the term is salvageable? Do you think that it's something that can still be useful? Because that was created, that was a developer. Who comment in the original BioShock? do you think the term is salvageable, or are we just gonna have to? It's become a cliche, and we're gonna have to sort of split the term up into its component parts.
Yeah, I really honestly feel it is salvageable because it is something, you know, that's very real. That you'll have a game that the story says one thing, but the gameplay has something else going on. They seem to be at odds with one another. And we do need words that describe concepts like that because it's an important part of gameplay. I mean, again, the BioShock Infinite example for Elizabeth is a really good example because for a lot of people, the fact that you're supposed to be protecting Elizabeth, but she kind of is like invincible, basically.
Hey, Booker, catch! Yeah.
Yeah. It's like she just runs off and the bolts don't affect her at all or anything. And it's like, but then suddenly something happens and, oh my God, she's in so much danger. She could die, but not really because of the gunfights. And like, that killed BioShock Infinite for a lot of people. They thought that this is not believable, or this was, I guess sloppy was a big thing that kind of came up, that this did not feel like it was thought out properly. There's a lot of cool things here, but it didn't come together. And I really think that it's vital that we do have words like that. It's just that we need to make sure as like, not just as a gaming community, but also as professionals that write about games. Like, we need to make sure one another, our colleagues, are using those words in a way that's most beneficial to our readers.
Yeah. So in terms of the games you enjoy playing, you said you're hooked on Dark Souls 3 right now.
It's really good.
Now, that is an interesting study of a game that is a deliberate slog. And it's a game that I think a lot of people would not call fun, but the way the mood and tone and setting and gameplay design work together, I think is where you get that cohesive experience from that people identify as fun, right? Everything is just like you're constantly dragging a rock in behind you, right? How, if you were going to analyze that game, just as an example, to let people see how you work, how would you approach it? What kind of topic would you consider writing about? And then how would you go about sort of laying it out for a reader?
That's a good point. So I think the first thing I want to think about is my personal experiences playing the game. What do I usually think about? One of the biggest things I think about right away is how frustrated I am with that game. I die so many times. And from there, what I think about is like, well, why am I frustrated with this game? And maybe more importantly, why do I keep playing it over and over again if I'm so frustrated with this game? And that can go into different directions. I might think about, you know, is this kind of an example of, say, how we approach skill curves in video games, that we hit a wall, but we keep on going over it because we know there's going to be a huge reward with mm-hmm. it. Or maybe issues of, say, attachment to games, or even the darker side of that is addiction. Maybe someone feels like they long for that sense of reward, and maybe that reward is reflecting something more personal in their life. And, you know, you don't want to stereotype gamers as that, because that's a huge problem, that people will stereotype gamers as some kind of weird addicts that are, like, always playing, and because they have, like, some weird kind of personal issue. Like, you don't want to touch that. But, you know, gaming addiction also is a real problem. So you might want to think about, do some people enjoy these kind of games because they have personal issues they work through with those games? And then that can take you in a different direction of, well, what personal issues do people connect with in those games? So when I'm playing a game and I'm supposed to be focusing on a boss battle, I'm thinking of like 20 of these things at once. And from there, I usually kind of get opinions from other players. Sometimes I'll interview someone. Like one article I wrote for the Ontological Geek, which was about actually the cognitive operation of how we approach skill curves in games and how that improves our cognitive functioning and how there's also the darker addiction side to it. That actually I interviewed two different people. One of them plays games a lot. One of them kind of doesn't as much anymore, but has a lot of experience with mental health issues. And for me, that was kind of an opportunity to take these outside issues from games and put them inside of it through something that in that case wasn't Dark Souls, but definitely Dark Souls relates to.
See, that's interesting because your background's literature, but that's almost a sociological approach.
Yeah,
right there.
It really is.
And that my literature profs would have kicked my ass for putting in because and this is the other difficult thing with the games as literature thing is
yeah.
that when you get into control design and gameplay design, it's impossible to get away from developer intent. And that's mm-hmm. a big no-no in core closely literature analysis.
Yeah, yeah.
Right? And people are like, what are you talking about? Well, basically, there's a war, guys, between a humanities approach, which is a big bad word in literature. It's just, no, this isn't humanities.
Yeah.
This isn't a humanities class. If you want to bring an author biography, go to a humanities class. So you can only take what's in the text.
Yeah.
And that is very difficult to do in a game because you have all this commentary, for lack of a better term. You have tutorials, you have game codecs, you have,
yeah.
and it's almost like our, you know, comfy little box that we learned in literature analysis just goes when it comes to a game because the game's not finished until you play it. So of
yeah.
course, your experience is where you're going to start.
Right.
And that, it's almost like we need like ludic literature. Like that's really what we're doing. And that's why it's ludonarrative is you've got the game theory.
Yeah.
But this begs the next question for me. How do you determine, because you write about, you know, women in games and things like that as well, a common complaint is you're not the audience, this game isn't for you. I mean, I'm sure you've heard this whenever
yeah.
you go, this could have been better, you know, this one
yeah.
little thing would have made this game significantly more enjoyable for me. How do you approach that? Because that's a major stumbling block right now in the discourse.
I think that's a good point, especially because I noticed there's actually an article I wrote, I guess about a year ago now, about the kind of indie, kind of like Hitman, but with anime game, Yandere Simulator, that's coming out. And I wrote an article that was about, well, maybe this doesn't take issues of sexual harassment seriously, it doesn't take issues of suicide seriously. And half the responses were like, I don't agree with this, but I think it's well-researched. And the other half were like, this game isn't for you, you don't understand anime at all, stuff mm-hmm. like that. It's like, I love anime, of course I do. And one of the things that kind of brought me to think about when I was seeing some of the responses from that was, well, just because there's, say, the so-called target demographic doesn't mean that other people aren't interested in those games. For instance, there's that kind of common issue. Actually, no, a better example. There's the new Battlefield game that was previewed recently, the World War I one that
Battlefield
we haven't seen
one.
A game.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. And when Battlefield 1 was first pitched to EA, it was actually rejected at first because people thought that it wasn't fitting kind of the cookie cutter code of you do present FPS or you do future FPS. And somehow they got it through past the EA execs. And that kind of reminded me of the fact that people treat the market demographic as this kind of really just tight and strict kind of way of thinking about the way people play games.
A fixed variable, yeah.
Yeah, exactly. And it's not true. It's not a fixed variable. There's people that don't hit that core demographic that publishers expect that want to play those games. You'll get many of people that don't hit kind of like the 18 to 27 white man that's like middle class or living with family or just getting recently into the job market. For games that are like first-person shooters or action adventures, you're going to get plenty of older women playing those games. You're going to get younger women playing those games. You're going to get really young boys playing those games as well as older men and stuff like that. So what's really interesting is people like to think that there's only one way to play a game and it's whatever the market kind of says, specifically the publisher says. But actually, people play games for various reasons and different kinds of people play games for various reasons. And I think the sooner that we as like a community realize that, the sooner that we're going to have more mature conversations about what it means to enjoy a game.
And I think we're also not giving, you know, that poor, beleaguered, straight white man enough credit for diversity mm-hmm. within that demographic. Because, I mean, case in point, there are RPG fans, there are shooter fans, there are adventure game fans. There are a lot of different gamers out there. And
yeah.
this idea that visible demographics are sufficient to know what the market wants is something that drives me crazy. Because
yeah.
on paper, I should like The Sims. I hate The Sims. That doesn't mean that I don't think The Sims shouldn't exist. I just,
yeah.
if I want to use the bathroom and cook, I can do that in the real world. I want an alien or a monster or a giant robot. That's what I want from games.
Yeah.
You know, but, you know, people, you know, and I know there are a lot of guys that like that, but then there are some other guys, and, you know, this is where the indie scene comes from, that they want almost like, you know, the tradition of comics with an X, games set more in a real or recognizable world.
Yeah. Exactly.
And so it's so strange to me how we do have this feedback loop that we've gotten locked into everybody fighting with each other, but if we reframe the question, mm-hmm. it's really, I think what somebody's gender on paper is immaterial. Mm-hmm. Because I mean, I got a freaking Shazam thing and a Plastic Man behind me and Superman,
right.
but then I've got the Flemeth Dragon. Like if
yeah.
somebody saw that without seeing me in the shot, they'd think this was a guy's house.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, one of the things that happens too a lot is that people forget just because you have like, say, a demographic that's white man and like, say, 18 to 27. Well, there's a lot of other factors that go into that too. Like, does that mean a gay man? Often gay men do play video games and you have, you know, men that may be disabled, men of color also fit into kind of that core demographic too. So you have white men alongside men of color playing video games. So really what's interesting is the fact that people think that just because you have like male and 18 to 27 as a demographic, that doesn't necessarily mean that that's the like the standard kind of stereotypical image of the gamer is like actually not true at all. And I think really on social media you see that best because there's so many different kinds of gamers on social media. There's a lot of gamers that you wouldn't expect to meet, except once you start getting really into the gaming community and meeting more people, well, you realize there's all kinds of different ways that people kind of become part of the gaming community and why they want to game in the first place. And I think we often, when we want to talk about more like social and gender issues in gaming, we have to veer away from just looking at things in terms of like giant generalizations, because that happens way too often. And it sounds nice for an article, but it deceives people if you're focusing on that without looking at the broader picture of what's going on.
Yeah. And I mean, for me, one thing I'm exploring lately is the fact that gender, sex and gender in a video game, because mm-hmm. everything is built from the ground up. It's all pixels. There's no real person there, right?
Yeah.
It's not the same. It's a mechanic. It's a system within mm-hmm. the work. It is not issues of what bathroom you use don't play into a video game. You know, issues
yeah.
of how you pee Don't go into most video games. There are some games it does matter.
Yeah.
But not many.
Right.
And I mean, other games like the Saints Row game, I always point out that game, you could walk into a plastic surgeon, redesign your character, and change your gender. Your voice did not have to match the predicted gender of your character. So you could have a male set voice in a female body.
Yeah.
And I feel like Saints Row really doesn't get enough credit for that years mm-hmm. before it was trendy, because it was done as a game mechanic instead of a narrative.
Yeah.
And now we're in this paradigm where developers are stuffing characters into a game for diversity purposes and they have absolutely nothing to do.
Yeah.
And there's some unintended results of that. I mean, did you play Assassin's Creed Syndicate?
No, but I did hear about that specific instance.
Yeah, and the character was a quest giver. You know, we seem to stick certain types of characters into these very passive roles. And I'm curious about how you feel about this, because I see that and I feel like it's insulting my intelligence. I mean, one of my biggest complaints about Dragon Age Inquisition is I thought, first of all, Iron Bull is referred to as pansexual. He is not. He's very invested in male and female gender roles.
Yeah.
He is. He treats men significantly differently than mm-hmm. women. But also, I wanted Krem to be a romance option. They had this, you know, okay, so you felt the same way. I felt like that was a real missed opportunity, and the fact that there were other characters in Skyhold mm-hmm. that, like Josephine and Cullen and characters like that who weren't part of your party, but were romance options. I felt like it, and I'm sure they just ran out of design time, but I thought Krem was such a sympathetic character, and you get that beautiful background of his story. And mm-hmm. I mean, they've established all the way back to Dragon Age Origins that the Qunari don't establish gender the same way that the other races do. It's based on your role, not your plumbing. And I just felt like they put that character in there. They spent a lot of time making them cool, but it wasn't as relevant as it could have been. I wonder, because, you know, this is the exploration of gender in a game. And in terms of crafting the game, whether it's a man or a woman doing the voice, how the character looks, do they have facial hair? I guess that is all relevant with a transgender character. But how relevant is biological sex in a video game?
Yeah, I was actually thinking alongside that point of the Baldur's Gate one that came out recently with the trans woman in that game. And I mean, for me right away, I was thinking like, okay, great. It's like you talk to her for 5 minutes. It doesn't sound realistic at all. That was actually a point I made when that first thing happened. Because like, I don't walk up to random people in the street and say, hey, I transitioned. Here's my family story. Like, we don't do that.
Here's what my name means.
Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, it gets worse though with Mizena, because
it does.
She is a priest of Tempus, mm-hmm. I believe. So there's this one point where all of a sudden, have you played through the game?
I'm just familiar with the actual like controversy. Yeah.
Spoilers, guys, here, this does give away a bit of a quest. Okay. But there's this one thing you need, because it has to do with gods being a real thing in sort of the Forgotten Realms. And so you have to find a priest of Tempus. And so you go to this previously very breathy and, you know, flouncy, almost floral character. And all of a sudden, the fact that her god is this battle god becomes, and the character totally changes. And it's this stereotype of,
really?
Oh, it's like, do your hormones need a tweak, honey? Like, how does that even work in an era of magic instead of science? And it kicked me out of the game so hard. And I'm sure some people will get kind of, you know, oh, how can she say that? You know, that comment about the physiological realities of transitioning, but this is from supporting people going through it.
Yeah.
It gets wild.
It does, yeah, it really does. And I mean, like, one of the things that hit me right away about Baldur's Gate is, like, the first thing I thought was, okay, how does this girl get her hormones in the first place? Does she have, like, a magic spell that does, like, if she does, that's cool, give it to me, I could use it, but...
But would it even mean the same thing in a world with magic, where someone can be transfigured into a chicken as well?
Yeah, and that's one of the things that really I think is important, because when we talk about issues of, like, lesbian and gay sexuality, like, there's not as much of a difference based on social context, because you're talking about attraction between two people. But a lot of trans issues are really based on the idea of how people transition in society and how that society affects them, which is why you're going to have so many different stories and, like, so much fracturing in the community between, like, even regions. And I think one of the interesting things is that they want to take the LGB kind of model and put it into trans issues, but you really just can't do that because it's so different. I think we're still kind of, like, it's not just gaming either. It's, like, writing too. It's representation in movies and TV. People want to take that idea of, okay, it's like LGB but with gender instead. Mm-hmm. And you need to have a really complex understanding of the kind of character you're writing, which is why I end up liking simple characters like Poison from Street Fighter and Final Fight, because it's just like, okay, yes, she's transgender and that really doesn't come up except, like, as a lore option, but, like, she's really awesome, and, like, it's no coincidence that, like, all these trans women love her, because it's like, I want to be Poison too, so...
See, funny you mention that, because to me, Vega is a genderqueer character.
Yeah.
And some people are just like, what? It's like, when I was a kid playing Street Fighter 2, I didn't know if Vega was male or female. Mm-hmm. They're like, okay, they're wearing no shirt, but there was a vaguely, for me, there was sort of a vaguely feminized element to Vega.
Yeah.
And as a kid, I'm just like, oh, that was something that distinguished him in the game. I didn't feel like it was making any political point. And that's what I love about those fighters, is they're wrestlers. Right. Yeah. I mean, Zangief is literally a wrestler, and for all the people who, I mean, what do you think about Street Fighter as a gender critic, for lack of a better term? I mean, there's stuff that the context of Street Fighter, for me, I don't care if a woman's slapping her own butt before a fight, but I feel like that's dismissive of the people who are bothered by it. So have you talked to people about this as sort of an active fan?
Yeah, so me and my friend Rachel are huge Street Fighter fans. We actually would stream it on Twitch now and then. She actually got me really into it in the first place. And we're both really kind of like got we're really focused on kind of gender issues in games and whatnot. We think about these things. And I think something that I noticed, and I think she kind of did too, is this idea that just because you have a character that like plays into like the very like muscular kind of man or like the feminized woman that has like some of these like assets like a butt and whatnot, that doesn't, like, you can't look at it at face value. Like, I think something, again, going back to Poison, is that yes, she's like, you could argue she's very sexualized because she basically just has like these cut off shorts and she has like this top that kind of falls off, but also like it's supposed to be a little bit of an in-joke. Like, yes, this is a little over the top, but this represents, like, her as a character, and by, like, reflection, her play style as a fighter. Like, she is kind of over the top. The way she plays is, like, she uses whips and other kind of, like, weird kind of kink-based stuff. And it's like, this is cool, but it's like, if you don't understand what the game's trying to do with that, you're going to come off thinking right away that's an issue of they're just trying to make her sexy to appeal to some audience for a baseless reason. And I think on the note, too, of comfort for players, I think that's a valid point, that if a player feels uncomfortable with a game, then they're uncomfortable with it. But I think also it's kind of like issues of, I think actually sexuality is a good point, like with kink issues. Someone might be uncomfortable with a specific thing, but that doesn't make it necessarily wrong. It just means that person is uncomfortable with it, which is great. Like, you don't have to be comfortable with things. But you should also respect the reason why people might be engage with these things, especially when it comes to issues of people and characters like, say, Poison or Chun-Li, where someone might identify with that character because
of Viper is a single mother.
Yeah, yeah. Exactly. That's it's very important to players for that reason. And by saying that it's automatically one thing because of one's opinion or perspective is going to get rid of the voices of the other people that have a different perspective on that.
Mm-hmm. I mean, it's funny because in a game, personally, I think you shouldn't level up to violence until you can handle a boob or two, personally. Because in terms of what requires more responsibility. Looking at a Playboy is a far less risk-intensive, thing in terms of adult behavior than, say, boxing or martial arts. And I mean, discipline, if you do any combat-based thing, discipline is so critical. And I just wonder why this has become this sticking point in terms of game design, because I mean, you mentioned the whips and chains in Street Fighter. I love Valdo as a character just because he is the embodiment of kink, right?
Yeah.
he is a man in bondage. He was bound by another dude. I mean, it is so, there's so much dominance and submission in Soul Calibur, and everybody's like, what? I'm like, no, it's all about what sword controls you, and it's all about power dynamics and how much free will. I mean, a lot of these characters have no free will. Voldo has no free will, hence his character design. And I think it's so funny that people have that reaction and they'll go like, oh, Voldo. And I'm like, yeah, that's why he's cool.
Yeah.
You know? And I feel the same way, like Cammy is cool because she's got that nice intermarrying. If you look at her from a front, she's sort of taking on that masculinized persona of the beret and, you know, the military, but then you turn around, it's like, hey, party. And do you find there is greater diversity? Because I can't figure out why my responses to these characters are so different from other people. Do you find there is a greater range of opinions and reactions than it is being expressed in the media right now?
I really think so. I think a big part of it is that people don't necessarily want to, or want to is not the best word. They just don't feel like expressing specific reasons why they're attached to different characters. I know it's a big thing in the fighting game community is that people legitimately do like the character design behind characters. They might choose characters for various reasons, like, say, play style or moveset, whatnot. But, I mean, character design is also really important. I remember when the Ken hairstyle came out and everyone made fun of Ken's hairstyle, saying, look, it's so weird. And it was just like, why did they do this? This is not the Ken that I know that's like has this weird kind of best friend slash rivalry with Ryu. Like, why did they change it? And it's wrong to think automatically that people don't care about those character designs. And I think a big part of it is that if someone's not familiar with a series, or if someone doesn't understand kind of the underlying, kind of going back to literature and the ideas of that, like the underlying subtext of what that game wants to do with that character design, then they're going to get the wrong images and they're going to get the wrong ideas from it. But if you really kind of wrap yourself up in that world, if you really spend the time to play it and really look at what that game's doing, you're going to find out the things that seem like sexualized objectification, you're going to compare that like in relation to other aspects of that game and start to realize that actually, no, it's not about like objectifying women. It's about what that specific characteristics that the character has that are shown off based on her costume, what that means and characterizes them as a character. And I think that's really important that people just don't always pick up right away because they're looking at it through one lens. But games it's not a linear medium. So that means also you need to look at things through multiple lenses.
Now, I know with the Street Fighter, the whole hot Ryu thing.
Yeah.
I raised an eyebrow at that because a lot of the same services who were sneering at Cammy and at, you know, less with Crimson Viper, but the low-cut top. I mean, they complain she fights in heels. And I'm sitting here going, show me a person whose arms and legs stretch like Dalzim. Yes, I have a plastic man in the back. He does. But most people's limbs don't do that. And there aren't green men like Blanca. Why are we busting the chops of these female characters? But then Hot Ryu comes out. And the different reaction to that, you know, the exposed chest and the very, it just made me feel like all the criticisms of Street Fighter became completely hypocritical in that moment. Do you agree, or is there something I'm missing?
No, I think you're right. I think one of the big things is that, again, people get caught up in the idea of like objectification and a very kind of traditional lens of like objectification is like X portrayal plus power equals Y, but like you can't look at it that easily. It comes off as very hypocritical when someone's like, I almost call like the Jezebel approach. It's like you have this specific thing where you're like, this is bad when men do it, but it's great when women do it. It's kind of a similar thing. Like, it's bad that these women are objectified, but this is like the objectification of men and it's great. And it's like they're not thinking very critically. And I think part of it also is that they're, especially when it comes to the journalism aspect, they're writing things that they know is going to get clicks, it's going to get hits. Someone's going to show off the hot Ryu and it's going to be like, oh, wow, look at this. Either like, oh, we're finally getting some like objectification of men, or they're going to be like, oh, this is awful, you know, this is what feminism is doing to video games or something like that, I don't know. Mm-hmm. And and it's just like, it's like the critical thinking is not going on that you would hope that it is about these issues. And it causes this weird kind of feedback loop when you have like these two sides that are kind of like the polar opposites, and they're just like, they're battling with each other, and there's no middle where you can talk about and say, hey, you know, actually it's not so bad that this one thing happened, it's not so bad this one thing happened either, but we need to be a little bit more critical about the way we approach both of these things.
And when you say critical, that word has two meanings.
Right? Yeah.
There's criticism and there's criticism. And I'm glad you brought this up, because this is somewhere I wanted to go with you. Where do you think the boundaries are of criticism in the academic sense, in taking something apart? Deconstruction is probably the more accurate word. To stop it from becoming criticism, everything is awful, so says I.
Yeah.
How do you stop it? Because I see a lot of criticism being praised when it's the everything is awful kind, not the nuanced, here's the good and here's the bad. And again, I think back to school and go, my professors would have slapped me, you know, figuratively, for going wholly negative on something that clearly has distinct positives. So
yeah.
you seem very tied in to the, I don't want to offend you, but social justice wing, for lack of a better term. What's going on there?
Yeah, so I think a big thing is people are tempted to do generalizations for a lot of different reasons. I mean, one thing is that by generalizing, it can be easier to write about certain things. You just plug into whatever people are thinking and bam, you've got that kind of aspect of your article done. I think one of the biggest issues, though, that we're kind of dealing with is that we need to focus on, instead of plugging into those things, we need to look at things by doing research, and we need to look at kind of the hard facts of how people interact with things. And this is why I think it's really important to go out there and get some interviews, and specifically get some interviews where you're not necessarily shooting for an angle, but you just want to sit down with a gamer and kind of figure out what they think about things. I mean, a major problem that, again, we run into with these generalizations is that, kind of like you said with academia, it's so odd, because in academia we would dismiss these things right away as immature, but in games it's accepted as, well, this is the way it is, and this is actually some kind of really interesting criticism, when actually, you know, it's just really not. So I think one of the biggest problems that we're running into with that is that games seems to be at this kind of, like, I like to say it's almost like the teenage stages, where it wants to be taken seriously, but it has a few more hurdles to go over before it is serious. And I think on both sides, there is this issue of, if you want to be critical of one thing, people get upset right away because there is this sense that gaming is not as mature as people want it to be yet. When you have the criticism where it's like, say you're talking about gender issues in first-person shooters, like maybe say Doom, or you're talking about BioShock, you get kind of that pushback because people might feel, I don't know if insecurity is the right word, but there is kind of this sense of insecurity that comes with more serious conversations. But on the other hand, if you want to criticize the way people that are talking about those issues talk about them, there's also that pushback, because there is this sense that you can't criticize these people, because what do we have left in gaming if you criticize these people? But actually, you know, to take this medium seriously, you also need to take its critics seriously. And that means that you need to say, actually, there's multiple ways of thinking about gender in games, which people don't want to do because, again, they seem a little insecure about the footing that we currently have.
Yeah, I think there's an element of, I just want to turn my brain off, and that's fine, right? Like, don't consume the content that doesn't match your experience, but don't attack the content either. I mean, I think that if you put something out there, and I know you've gone through this because I've seen some of your videos that got some pushback, but
yeah,
you know, if you're going to put something out there, you have to expect a certain amount of peer review, people engaging with your work and commenting on it. And personally, as somebody who gets a lot of comments on YouTube that are really great, that excites me. When someone leaves a comment and they've clearly thought about it, and they don't just say, well, I didn't agree with everything, but F this else, and they actually engage, that's awesome. But there seems to be, you're right, there seems to be this hesitation to flip over the rock and see what's underneath.
Yeah.
And I think because I love gothic horror, that's all about flipping over the rock and seeing what's underneath, right?
Yeah.
The blood as metaphor for sex because we couldn't talk about sex kind of thing.
Yeah.
But it's funny because that's all through games. Right?
Yeah.
Survival horror gets really deep. Even games that people think are just, you know, for fun, God of War and Assassin's Creed are two games. And even a lot of the adventure games use romantic art composition, romantic capital R, to inform the big emotional experience they want the player to have.
Yeah.
That's relevant to me. You know, when you're going, camera angle matters, right? So if the developer decides to pull way out so Kratos is only that big, that's saying something. You're taking
is,
this big, bad, muscular, shirtless, hyper masculine, sleeps with all the ladies, and making him tiny. And I feel like those moments are missed because in a game like BioShock, the original one, you don't get that. You don't get the sense of being off the ground. You don't get those. I mean, you're literally underwater in tubes, and it really used that tunnel shooter well. Because going back to that narrative and game thing, it used the sea bearing down on you to inform why you were getting at that game from the inside. And I thought that being thrown in, the original BioShock is one of the greatest openings in any game ever.
Oh, it's so
personally.
Good.
Yeah, the way, you know, Beyond the Sea is playing, you get in there and it's a, you immediately feel vulnerable because it's a wreck, it's a plane crash, so you immediately have that lone survivor thing, and then you're in. But to me, these conversations like we're having right now enhance my enjoyment of these things. When someone points something out to me I didn't consider before, like the slouchy shoulder in Street Fighter, I didn't think about that. You're right. You're completely right. I'm like, ooh, yeah, because everything's off center.
Yeah, it is.
It makes, that enhances my enjoyment of a game. So why do you think people have the opposite reaction, that they think it means games aren't fun to think about them?
Yeah, I think it's complicated. I think a big thing is that, again, it is kind of that insecurity of, you know, this is a medium that has traditionally been criticized, but also has a lot of growing still to do. I think, you know, games, it really is great right now, but we're really not seeing its full potential yet. There's so much more that's going to be able to do in the next few years. And I think people are just concerned about the direction, the growth that it's going. I mean, I know definitely talking maybe a little bit less about the social justice kind of community within games and more of kind of the hardcore traditional kind of gaming community. Sometimes there's a pushback to it because people are nervous that it's going to mean that they can't approach games with the kind of, I'm not going to think about this critically, I'm going to play it because I want to play a game because I had a long day at work and I want to relax. And for me, I always think of that as like, look, you don't have to like my work because my work is for a specific audience and I want you to respect my work, but also I respect the fact that sometimes you just want to like sit down, pull up your mouse and keyboard and like shoot in Doom for 2 hours because I know I love to do that too. So I guess a big part of it is that we're all just trying to figure out how to play along with one another, how to like build a community with one another, and we're still kind of struggling a little bit because we do have different motivations for what we want to talk about and what we want to do. And it can feel kind of messy at times. But, you know, another thing I did notice in the past 2 or 3 years is we actually are starting to see bridges pop up where you'll have people that are really into social justice and stuff, but then also say, like, yeah, I just sometimes want to sit back and play a game to relax. Like, I'm not going to think critically about it for a moment because I had a rough day at work and I just really need to shoot, like, some demons for 2 hours. Again, Doom, but...
I mean, I don't think Doom... Doom is a game... I don't want to insult it because I think what Doom does brilliantly, But
it does,
Doom,
really does.
Doom is calibrated to give you a bunch of big bad enemies to shoot you don't feel bad shooting. Because
yeah.
they are demons, they're in the embodiments of evil. That is a conscious choice. There is no moral ambiguity. Die.
If only you could talk to the monsters.
if only we could talk to the monsters in the monster's
yeah.
point of view. You know, all of a sudden it flips and you're in the mind of the monster. No, it's
yeah.
not that. You're not even supposed to think the monsters have a mind. It's not
yeah.
Years of War. We're not suddenly going to see another side, right?
Yeah, no, we're not.
And there's nothing wrong with that.
Yeah.
But this labeling something junk, and this is something very dear to my heart, because I'm a huge fan of the early pulps. The,
yeah.
you know, Strange Adventure, the John Carter of Mars, the stuff that inspired things like Star Wars and Halo and stuff like that. That was dismissed as junk at the time, and it was some of the most imaginative writing I have ever seen. I find there is a purity to it that isn't there in the slicks, in the smarty pants stuff. Like, I'd rather
yeah.
read Tarzan than the Jungle Book. I'll watch the Jungle Book as a movie, but trying to read the Jungle Book as a book, I'm like, oh dear God. You know, you're trying to read before bed and the book's falling on your face because it's too slow for the way I want to engage. Tarzan,
yeah.
meanwhile, it's a guy swinging through the trees and fighting monkeys. I mean, that's awesome.
Yeah, I'll take it any day.
yeah, and it's sort
yeah.
of, but that's junk because it's action driven.
Yeah.
Which is a fairly new thing in terms of, I mean, we only got that when we got into the concept of a character driven story.
Yeah.
And like, where do you think, because this is happening in indie games with a game like Gone Home or Life is Strange being seen as serious, and a game like Doom being seen by the same people who consider those games serious as junk, but then you've got the flip side of the people who like games like Doom and Halo and Call of Duty dismissing a Gone Home or Life is Strange as not a real game.
Yeah.
How are we going to get people to understand that both opinions are valid, but they are not definitive?
Yeah, I think one good thing is right away to show people, people really seem to be attached to the idea of, even if they don't like a game, they love the design choices that go into it. And I think a big problem is that people don't understand right away that just because a game doesn't appeal to you doesn't mean that it was thought out in 5 minutes in some boardroom or some, like, I don't know, some diner is like, hey, you're going to shoot demons. Okay, let's get this out in 2 months. Like, it's not like that at all. It's just not. It's so, so different. And I think one big thing is to get people to realize how much hard work is put into these games. Like, I think with Life is Strange, people said, like, this doesn't appeal to me because it's about women and it's about, like, also queer women, and it's touching on those issues of young adult kind of life and transitioning into adulthood, and okay, also there's a hurricane coming, and I've never experienced hurricanes. And I think one thing is that people didn't appreciate that game right away, but once they started to realize kind of the work that had gone into the puzzle making of it and the work that went into the writing of it, and like how difficult decisions can be in that game, and how nonlinear that story is, because you can really mess up life in Arcadia Bay if you're not careful. I know I did. I got so many people to have awful lives now in my run through it.
I approached that game with apprehension because of that. It was like, no, I don't
yeah.
want to make everything bad.
Yeah, it's like, oh my God, that happened. I'm going to like stop playing this game for like 2 months and then come back when I've forgotten it. It's like, and I think it's stuff like that. Like and also with the first person shooter stuff being a great example of like action games not being taken seriously. I think actually, I started writing for Killscreen recently, and Killscreen gets a lot of flack from kind of the hardcore gaming community because they focus on the cultural issues. But you'll also get a lot of articles from Killscreen that are going to talk about things like the design choices behind specific games. I actually have one coming out relatively soon as a feature article I did with an interview with the developer of Bunker Punks, and that game was a one-man team. And it's kind of amazing what the developer was able to pull off as a one-man team. And that's a game where it's a roguelike first-person shooter, but it's really smart about politics. It's not something that you would think about right away if you think of roguelike plus shooter equals four hardcore gamers. But actually, it's like really intelligent about the future of where like the United States is going. Mm-hmm. And I think one thing is that you need to get people to appreciate things like that, that you might not appreciate the gameplay elements, but there's a lot going on in the story that you would like. Or you might not appreciate the story itself, but the game design has a lot of thoughtful decisions put into it. And that's really what's going to get people kind of on these two different sides to understand, well, okay, I don't like this, but I respect it. And that's what we really need, is the respect.
Yeah, and that's hard when, first of all, we are overly obsessed with spoilers, as far as I'm concerned. I mean, if a story can't survive a spoiler, everybody knows how every Shakespearean tragedy ends. I mean, this, again, it's a new thing. People knew a comedy went this, a tragedy meant that. They went in knowing, oh, it's tragedy, everybody's gonna die.
Oh, no, don't spoil it for me.
Yeah, oh, no, sorry, I just ruined Macbeth and Hamlet and Othello. No. And yeah, but, you know, this is a new, because audiences wanted to know.
Yeah.
Satisfying audience expectations is part of the key of popular writing. And we are obsessed now with spoilers, and it makes it hard to champion a game in its early days when the sales matter.
Yeah.
And I mean, I found some artful ways around it, but at that point, it just becomes like, look, guys, trust me, there's more to it.
Yeah.
Yet there is so little trust now in the whole process of journalism, and so people want to watch a game before they play the game. And that ruins games like, say, the new King's Quest, that's all about puzzle solving and narrative, like, story choices, how you want to proceed.
I
don't know why somebody would watch that game in advance, but they do, because they don't trust the traditional review process. And that makes me very sad, because I know when I was younger, I would have much preferred more variety in the review, but now if all the review scores don't line up, people start taking out change.org petitions to get something with like, it's gone crazy. That is nuts, that a dissenting review is seen as an attack on the game.
Yeah.
And this has got to concern you as well, as someone who's writing clearly from a place of love. So What do you think we do about this beyond getting rid of the whole idea of score aggregation? Like, is there a way other than that to deal with this issue?
You know, first off, I think score aggregation is an interesting issue, because, I mean, like, look at Roger Ebert and, you know, doing movie criticism. He always did, like, the 5-star review process. Like, even this amazing film critic starred his reviews. And that's what people don't realize, is that it's not just about the aggregate system. I do think the aggregate system has a lot of problems, and people treat it as like word of God in a way that's like really just, it's just not healthy at all for the industry. But I also think that you can have it. I think the key really is to get more complex kind of reviews. And that's kind of like a really broad and kind of general term, because like, what is a complex review? And I think a big thing that we really need to focus on, not just as professionals, but also as gamers that read reviews from our colleagues, is we want to make sure that there's nuance to the reviews that we're reading, is that someone's going to consider that, hey, this mechanic was not so great, but there was also this aspect that was really good. Because then going back to the idea of design versus story, a lot of people really appreciate when a reviewer takes the time to say, the gameplay in this was not so great, but the story was very interesting for X, Y, and Z reasons. Because you have a lot of gamers that are going to say, I don't really care as much about the gameplay if the story interests me. Especially the case for things that are more like, say, dating sims or visual novels, where, you know, what's really important is the story is holding up. Who cares about, you know, if like 5 mini games are not so fun? But if the story is great, then you're going to get a good hit. So, I mean, I think a big thing is that I also think we really do have an industry that has kind of, where readers are attached to the personalities that review games. Mm-hmm. And sometimes that's a great thing, but other times it can be a bad thing for different reasons. Like, mm-hmm. we'll have things like, you know, someone wrote a review and we're going to make fun of them because it's the same kind of review they always write where they focus on social issues too much. It's like, Well, I mean, the reviewer doing their, that's like the angle they want to do. What's wrong with that? They have an audience that likes that. And I think we need kind of respect for different reviewers' position, but if there's a calling for different ways of reviewing games, we need publications also to say, you know, look, maybe we do have some readers that want kind of more the hardcore kind of, I want to focus on game design specifically focus. That's not a bad thing. That's an important part of gaming. So, you know, maybe hire some reviewers that are doing that. And vice versa. Okay, we actually do have readers that care about social issues. Maybe hire those kind of reviewers too. So I think it's kind of a complex thing, but it's really important to have at least diversity of opinions and approaches.
Yeah, see, I think part of it is that game reviews aren't financially lucrative enough to have more than one opinion at a time. I mean, an outlet will get one copy, and then it's all... I mean, I like the move to post-launch analysis, but at the same time, I get into this thing where I am honest about the things I like about a game and the things I don't like about a game. And if I really enjoy a game and I'm going at it like, this is great, I recommend it wholeheartedly.
Yeah.
That's when I become very aware of, okay, now I have to be brutally honest about what's wrong with it too, because I don't want to oversell it and have a player walk away disappointed. But in some of these beloved franchises, I mean, man, you got ripped apart if you said there was anything wrong with BioShock Infinite.
Oh, yeah.
Like, anything. I got ripped for criticizing the ending, for criticizing the racial caricature element.
Oh, yeah, it was bad.
Yeah, it wasn't that... I thought it was evil. I thought it was lazy.
It was. It really was. It was too safe. I think that was the big thing. Because, like, looking at so many different ways they approached race and that, they were very, very polite with the word usage compared to what would have actually happened in that society. And I think, like, there's a conversation to have about, you know, should have they done this? Should have they done that? But I think they really did a disservice to... showing the horrors of the era by like playing it a little too safe with some of those issues.
And some of them, and yet others, you had this inexplicable anti-Semitic slur on the vending machines with the kippahs. And for me, you know, BioShock Infinite came out during Passover that year, because Passover and Easter are very similar. And I'm sitting here, the game comes out on Passover. I was playing it after the Seder. I just, you know, put all the dishes away, a lot of dishes, and then sit down. And I'm like, oh, give me up. Like, you know, if that is there, I want to know why. So, okay, this is an anti-Semitic society. And there, you know, there were little, the comment referred to as half a Jew and things like that. And they kind of got on the black-white racism, but then the Asian racism was not touched on at all. And yet, here we have the stereotypical yellow peril Chinese arms dealer.
Yeah.
And, you know, people are start going, it's not, they start getting all freaked out because you think they're saying the game is evil.
Right.
I'm not saying that. I'm saying this is something that I went... Come on, really? It's unoriginal.
Yeah,
you know, it's unoriginal. The politics, and who cares, is politics. I don't play game to politic. But the effect that certain people will experience by seeing the... Because you go, yay, there's a black woman who is a lead in this game. And she's awesome and cool, and she's a leader, and I like her. And then you've got that when she smears the blood down...
Oh, yeah.
And she suddenly goes savage for no apparent reason.
And is going to kill a kid, yeah.
I felt betrayed by the game, because I felt like they were going one way and then they were trying to do this false moral equivalency while Booker's in my ear going, oh, everybody's the same. Shut up, Booker. Let me decide that for myself, right? Yeah. Don't make me angry at Troy Baker, game. You know, it's one of those things where these are the things where... And this is where intent matters, right? Because why do I criticize this? I'm criticizing it because I think I see what they were going for. It certainly was not what they ended up with. I want to be a process of the next time they try to make a game, because I do support the developer, they're going to get it. They're going to get what they want on screen next time.
Yeah.
That is so hard to do in this climate, right? I mean, you...
Yeah, it really is.
You have to eat your word count prefacing things with, no, I liked it. I really liked it. I'm a fan of this game. But... And then you have to hedge. And you can't just make your point. Unless it is a certain set number of acceptable points, right?
Yeah, exactly.
So, other than just... Because... I'd say, what do we do? But I don't think anybody knows what to do at this point. And I think we can sort of agree just doing it and letting people get used to it hasn't worked.
It really hasn't, no, not at all. I think a big thing, too, is that there's so much pushback because there is kind of this sense of this is how people have traditionally done it. So why change that necessarily? Because people do like kind of this just like, here is the game. This is how the story is. This is how the gameplay is. Based on those things, I give it a 7.5 out of 10 or whatever. Right. And it's like, I think a big thing is the exposure does help a little bit, but yeah, it's a difficult kind of question. And I think it's one that it kind of goes back to the issue of the industry itself and kind of the medium still kind of entering into maturity. And part of that maturity is about the way specifically kind of its consumers, its players, its fans approach things. I do think more exposure time is, over time is gonna help. I think though also starting with those kind of reviews where it's like, I like this, but, and then slowly building kind of more of a portfolio where you work on those kind of like, this is the game and here's the kind of critiques I have of it. And then going into kind of like, facts or background about the game design research, it seems people really are going to say, okay, I disagree with this, but I respect it, if they can feel that the writer put in a lot of research into it. Like, some of the most controversial articles I've done have also been my most respected ones, because I put a lot of time into looking into, like, say, developer background or research for statistics or... I don't know, professional opinions on things. And people end up saying, look, I disagree, but there's something here I can feel that was a lot of hard work that I can respect. And I think maybe the move to like grounding our reviews in kind of like different facts and developer opinions that are like part of research are maybe going to help that issue a little bit. It's not a silver bullet, but I think it might open up the door a little bit.
Well, I think definitely showing an informed opinion is significant. That's interesting because, I mean, again, we're back to this thing where there's a contingent in games that wants games to be considered significant enough artistic properties that they are open to academic criticism.
Yeah.
But that method that you just described for the consumer, which we are, you know, primarily responsible for informing, that gets laughed out of art and literature-based academic criticism because it's too much background.
Yeah.
And we're back to this thing where we're stuck again. It's almost like we need a game criticism methodology in academia.
Yeah.
We have to stop piggybacking off of literature because it's not working. The modalities are not compatible. Like, you've convinced me of that, just with what you're saying, that you can't review a game the way you review a book or a movie. Mm-hmm. It's just, developer intent matters too much to do
it
a
does.
Death of the author approach. I mean, I call it, I named it the author is sleeping approach to game criticism, that the author's there and what they intended was relevant, but... You don't have to agree that they succeeded that. Like, once they've shipped, okay, now the player gets their hands on it. So the author's not dead. You know, what Hideo Kojima intended for Metal Gear matters.
Mm-hmm.
I still do think, you know, that's an instance where I think quiet's great. I can understand why some people wouldn't think quiet is great.
Yeah.
I would like to have a conversation about why I think quiet's great and why somebody else doesn't without being accused of internalized misogyny or you know, vagina Uncle Tomming. And
yeah.
You know, this drives me crazy because I'm sure you've had this experience where you go to a conference, you get together with friends, and you have a really neat conversation about things that everybody loves.
Yeah.
And you'll say something and somebody else will go, really? I didn't get that at all. This was my interpretation of it.
Yeah.
And somebody's like, really? I like this character much better. I couldn't stand that person.
Yeah.
No one's offended. It's good conversation. You walk away from it, not just still friends, but it was an enjoyable moment. And people blame the internet, but I don't think that's it, because I have sat down with the people that are screaming on the internet and they can't have a conversation like this in person. So
yeah,
what's happened to the industry that it has seemed to attract these very fragile personalities that can't handle a dialogue with their audience, and then audiences who can't seem to handle a disagreement with a personality. Like, people take it as a real offense if a personality they enjoy doesn't agree with them on something. And do you have some insight where this fragility has come from?
Yeah, I think this is actually a good example, even though, like we established, can't compare games to literature, but I think it is a good example of the way we handle things in literature, and even say like writing programs like MFAs and whatnot. And there's this kind of idea that when you have that dialogue, there's a discourse there, there's a conversation about, I have this one interpretation, you have another interpretation. And then there's kind of like this understanding that once you hit that, you know, that's that, and we can move on to another kind of aspect to talk about. We have different interpretations that we can bring together while still maintaining the text as something that's interesting or enlightening or whatnot. Mm-hmm. And I think just one issue that we keep on running into again and again is because people are not used to that approach of thinking about things, and people really treat, like, say, personalities, review personalities, as almost like a word of God kind of thing, or like just really seeing them as like something that's bigger than they really are. They start to become so attached to the idea. I think a lot of it is teaching people that, you know, hey, just because one person has this opinion, you don't necessarily need to treat that as the end-all be-all. I think it's also a big part of it is just that people think of developers and game designers, they have a very specific view of how the industry works because of their background as gamers to begin with. Like, I noticed there's actually a lot of people into games that also have backgrounds in more STEM fields, and they might not be familiar with the humanities approach to critical thinking, and that's not necessarily a bad thing, it's just their background and whatnot, but they might have a very specific idea where, because based on their background or the way they think about the world, they split things into correct or wrong, and there's no kind of in between. There's either this is the approach or this is not the approach. And it's understandable because games is it's a segment of tech. It's also something that has a lot to do with like hardware design, it's something that has to do with programming, it's something that has to do with logic, that, you know, you need a really strong grasp of those things in order to understand gaming. But I also think too that because there's many parts of the community and also even the industry itself inside that might not have the exposure, or they just don't think of things in terms of critical thinking kind of studies, they're going to end up with that kind of approach where there's right or wrong. But I think exposure over time is going to change that, but it's difficult because you're trying to get a whole segment of the community to think of things differently and introduce them into a way of thinking that they've never considered before in the past. And that's really difficult.
That's a great insight, because it actually leads to my next question for you. It almost answered it in advance, that black or white, a one and a zero, a right or it's wrong.
Yeah.
You may have already answered this. Do you think that's why the top names in games criticism right now, and mm-hmm. I'm talking Yahtzee, Jim Sterling, Total Biscuit, Anita Sarkeesian, you know, all Lee Alexander, all down the road.
Yeah.
They are best known and their fans follow them because they excel at being profoundly negative on
yeah.
something they don't like. Is that, do you think that's because of that binary, the either it's right or it's wrong and there's no shades of gray?
I actually really think so, yeah. There was actually kind of in and out of what we've been talking, it reminded me of a pitch that I sent in recently. I read an essay that Merit Kopas did for The State of Play about sexuality in games. And one of the things that she focused on right away was how great Saints Row was for kind of the things we talked about, her specific angle.
Yeah,
it's so good. And one of the things that she really focused on was like romance is something that you can just like walk up to a character, romance them. It's like, hey, okay, we're back into the story. And then she compared it to Mass Effect as something that was like very manipulative, because you're basically saying the right things you want your partner to hear, and you keep on doing that over and over again, which is a good point. But I was also thinking at the same time, well, you can't really say that in 2015 or 2016, because we're getting a little bit more complicated romance roles in BioWare stories. They're getting more advanced, they're getting a little bit more sophisticated compared to the early Mass Effect approach, which was basically like, you click the right things a few times and you're done. You're getting more of like a complicated kind of story background with these characters now. So I've been thinking about things like that, and I think part of the negativity is that people really like to hear someone say, this thing is awful or no good, or this thing has problems for XYZ reasons, because it's entertaining. People love to rip into things. But you run the risk of creating this kind of like dichotomy where it's like good, bad, that's it, nothing else. And it's the same kind of problem. And I honestly think that's not one tied to the kind of STEM issue, although it's related. Mm-hmm. I think that's really more because of the fact that it's so appealing to so many people to say things are simple and easy and not complicated that you then kind of create these boxes, and then people want to listen to that because it's easy to digest. You don't have to think about it as much. And that's not to say these critics don't think about things, because I think they have very complicated and nuanced understandings, for sure. But it also means that the reason why people tune in is sometimes because they just want to hear a very simple approach to things. And for some critics, they do really focus and thrive on simple approaches where it's A or B. And it's not necessarily bad, but it also needs to be balanced out is the really big thing.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, these critics have other skills, but it seems that the reason people, and they don't identify their negative, but smart because they go negative. Funny because they go negative. You know, challenging because they go negative, informative because they go negative. You know, important things to say in gaming tend to be criticism, like negative comments about games, as opposed to defenses of them. You know, someone, you know, looping Grand Theft Auto into 1960s and 70s smut zine tradition is not going to be seen as informative because it's defending problematic content, but it very much is a free speech exercise in the interactive space. It's deliberately disgusting, right?
Especially games like Manhunt too, so, you know, tied into Rockstar as well, which is exactly like all about pushing those boundaries.
And Bully Bully had a different element to it, but I mean games like Hitman as well. I think that and again this design, and we say this design, well, this is intent, literature prof would smack me upside the head again, but they designed a character with no empathy as a protagonist. This matters because you are the reason I like the Hitman games is because they are experiments in cold-blooded murder.
They really are
plan them. You have to clean up after yourself. You are a hitman. You are not a spree killer. You are not a thrill killer. You are not a mercy killer. You are not a defensive killer. You are a hitman.
Yeah.
And I think Agent 47 is a brilliant protagonist for those games because it really makes you think about the fact that he has been dehumanized.
Yeah.
Right?
Especially the new series too, with the kind of opening prologue and the intro section. I thought it was really fascinating because they really focused on that moment that like, is this such a good idea to introduce this assassin that is like literally a sociopath? It's like literally does not feel emotions or anything. And Diane is like, yes, I feel like I can handle him. And it turns out that Diane can because she's a great handler. And it's so fascinating because I actually think that's a really good example of a game that ties writing alongside with the gameplay really well, because it's so important. I'm not sure if Hitman would be as popular if you targeted like a dad with three kids. That was your hit target. Like that would, I think people would be kind of turned off to that, but your targets are like people that extort others, they're exploitative, they're manipulative, they're murderers, they're politically corrupt. Some of them run like all sorts of like sex trafficking rings and stuff like that. It's really like these are awful people, and it's a sandbox where the game invites you to go and kill them, and also you don't have to feel bad about it because your main character certainly does it. And I think it's just so fascinating because people will immediately say that the writing in those games is kind of subpar because of kind of the direction that say like Blood Money goes, but And, you know, not to mention Absolution, which had a lot of issues, but
oh,
I
you
mean,
mean the sexy nuns or the actual writing of it? The fact that they almost broke their pattern in that they tried to go emotional
oh,
and it didn't quite work.
Yeah, it's
okay.
That's actually, yeah, it's a great example actually of how important that aspect of the story is, because they tried to do that, and they also tried to do like the daughter plot line thing,
I
and
was
it's
gonna
just,
say, don't put a kid in Hitman.
Yeah, don't. The whole point of the series is that like children are victims in that series. Like that's the point. Like yes, they're trying to do that to an extent too, but like 47 is not ushering in like this like slightly young adult story. Like that's not what the series is about. And it's just, but it's fascinating because it really does prove that you need some strong writing and this understanding from developers of what their game world is in order to have good gameplay, because people will not play the game. And also, you know, I think it kind of causes like a double effect where if you have writing that doesn't understand what the game is supposed to be, you tend to find games that also have gameplay that doesn't understand what's supposed to be, which Absolution was really
Yeah. I mean, I think there is, again, I go back to understanding of narrative tradition, because that is very much, I mean, it fits into noir, it fits into, you know, crime fiction, because noir is a subset of crime fiction, but, you know, that is very different than a game like BioWare or God of War or Skyrim. That, and I mean, Skyrim is a classic example of a game where all the images are romantic and then all the dialogue is very almost proto-realist in that it's bland and very geopolitical as opposed to lofty. You know, everything is sort of done down here, which totally works in Hitman, because that is very much real world. That is very almost a, well, Kane and Lynch goes more into verite with the shaky cameras and you know, the awareness of it being filmed. But I think these are all filmmaking techniques. I mean, this is borrowing from film, but these are all relevant to getting that vision across, because when a developer has this big lofty, you know, existential save the world thing, and then they start trying to get into that, you know, they're doing Kerouac with elves and dwarves, that's when I think it doesn't work. You know, they're trying to do too many things at once. They're trying to show how clever they are. And instead of making one good thing at a time, but people will argue me that you should be able to fuse traditions, but I don't think it works personally.
No,
you know,
I think you're right. Yeah.
Yeah.
I think a big part of it is just that, it's like you can't make those connections in many cases, because it's, like you said, it's trying to do a lot at once, but also there's this aspect of it that becomes kind of like almost pretentious about it. Like, oh, you're comparing the lineage of this game to Kerouac. Well, like, what do you mean by that? Do you mean specifically that it's trying to be on the road about elves? Because I don't think this game necessarily is. It's more like there's different ways to talk about it. Like, you could mention that, say, this game is trying to tap into the culture of like the beatniks, but also do something else with it. But it's just people want to focus specifically on finding like these images to relate that say like, oh, gaming has this lineage with this other really respected medium because this author. But actually, like, you know, it's not quite that. It's like, that's kind of like one of the many signs that this is like a medium that is going through that transitional stage that is kind of in its teenage years, because it wants people to take it seriously by referencing other kind of medium, other kind of artists from different mediums, and then expecting that that's going to give some kind of credibility or credence or whatnot to those arguments, instead of having this sense of confidence that your argument is going to be so mature and so complicated and so nuanced that it's going to speak for itself of how powerful that medium is.
Awesome. Well, we've been talking for an hour and 20 minutes now, Anna, so I think it's a good time to wrap. I'd love to have you back on one of our roundtables in future, maybe talking about that game romance mechanic. That, I think, would be a really interesting topic. But how can people find your work? How can they find the stuff you do?
Oh, yeah, sure. So I'm on a few sites. I'm on Killscreen. I'm on FemHype. I'm actually an advisor for the site. You can find me on Twitter. I'm at SpaceDoctorPhD, all one word, doctor, you know, forward. I'm also on YouTube under the same thing. If you type in youtube.com, you know, that thing slash and then SpaceDoctorPhD, you'll find some of my video work. The best way to really follow my stuff, though, is on Twitter, which I regularly will post articles that I do and just kind of talk about the kind of day-to-day thoughts I have on games criticism.
Awesome. Fabulous. Thank you, Anna.
Thanks. It was great.